Hello everyone. So today we will talk about the resolution in first order logic and also the resolution inference rule in the first order logic. So in the last chapter we already learned about the what is first order logic and what type of statement came under the first order logic and what are the knowledge representation for the first order logic and how knowledge engineering is doing inside the first order logic. So in today's lecture we will understand about the resolution inference rule and also all type of resolution after learning this chapter you will totally understand about what type of resolution came under the first order logic and what are the resolution rules are made for the first order logic. So let's start resolution in first order logic. So resolution is the theorem proving technique that proceed by building a means of proof. Okay, that is proof by contradictions. So it was invented by the mathematician John Allen Robinson in the year 1965, and the resolution is used if there are various statements are given and we need to prove a conclusion of those statements. So unification is the key concept in a proof by resolution, and in the last chapter we already learned about the unification, what is unification in the first order logic. So by using the unification key concept we will prove this resolution. So resolution is a single inference rule which can efficiently operate on conjunctive normal form or a clause form. First of all we learn about what is clause and what is conjunctive normal form. So clause is a disjunction of literals, is called clause. It is also known as a unit clause. Now what is conjunctive normal form? A sentence represented as a conjunction of clause is said to be conjunctive normal form. And as we know, we all know that the conjunction is actually also known as AND logic, right? AND logic. So whatever statement or a sentence will be represented as a conjunction of clause, it's said to be conjunctive normal form. Okay, means CNF. So the resolution rule for first order logic is simply a lifted version of propositional rule. Resolution can be resolved two clause if they contain complementary literal which are assumed to be standardized apart so that they share no variables. So as you can see here, so many variables are written, right? Where Li and M of J are complementary literals. Okay, so these are actually a complementary literal. So this rule is also called a binary resolution rule because it only resolves exactly two literals. For example, let's take an example. We can resolve two clause which are given as a, for example, if X is animal, okay, if X is animal, or X love any f of X, okay, then and also A and B doesn't love to each other, or A and B doesn't kill each other. So the two complementary literals here, right? One love, inside the love we pass f of x and x, and another literals is not love AB, right? Here we have our two literals. So these literal can be unified with the unifier theta, and which can be written as a slash f of x. Means we already know that what is the meaning of a slash f of x. Means definitely a will be replaced by the f of x, and also b slash x means b will be replaced by the x, and it will generate a resolvent clause, that is animal g of x or not kill f of x x. So now just understand what are the steps used for the resolution. Okay, so the first step for the resolution is conversion of fact into first order logic. Okay, conversion of facts into first order logic. After that, we convert first order logic statement into CNF, that is conjunctive normal form. After that, in a third step, we neglect the statement which need to prove. After that, in the fourth step, we will draw resolution graph, and that is unification graph. Okay, so to better understand, first we will take a one example. Okay, to understand this and to understand this resolution step. So I'm taking a one example, as you can see here. See, this is an example in which some statements are given, like first statement is given as a John like all kind of food. This is a first statement. After that, apple and vegetable are food. This is a second statement. After that, anyone eat and not killed in food. So this is a third statement. After that, Anil eat peanuts and still alive. Okay, this is a fourth statement. After that, Harry eat everything that Anil ate. Prove by resolution that John likes peanut. Okay, means here almost five statements are given, and we have to prove that John like peanuts. Okay, so let's understand. Just take a first step. Okay, that means firstly I have to convert this statement into first order logic. Okay, so in the first step, we will convert all the given statement into the first order logic. As you can see here in this diagram, we convert all the statement in the first order logic. Means for the statement A, that is John like all kind of food, we are convert this statement in the first order logic as a for all x. If x is a food, then definitely it like by then definitely x is like by John. Okay, so this is a first order logic statement. Now for the second statement, that is apple and vegetable are food. So for that we convert first order logic statement as a if apple is a food, and also conjunctive you can say that conjunctive operator or and operator, and also vegetable is a food. So if both are true, then only in that case it will be given as a. So I am converting apple and vegetable are food in a first order logic like this. Next statement, that is C statement, is anything anyone eat and not kill and not killed is food. So it will be written as a for all x and for all y. If x eat y, okay, if x eat y, and after that and operator, not killed x if it eat food y. Okay, so like that all the statement are written here. Okay, all the six statement we already checked that. We already took that example. So it was firstly converted in the first order logic. In the second conversion of first order logic into the CNF. Okay, so let's take a conversion of first order logic into CNF. So in the first order logic resolution, it is required to convert the first order logic into CNF, as CNF from makes easier for resolution proof. Okay, so first we have to eliminate all implication and then we retrieve. So as you know that once we remove this implication, then for example A implies B, then we can write here, we can write that statement as a, if we want to remove implication, then we can write a not A and disjunctive operator and B. Okay, so same like that, in the first statement implication is there. So food for all x, if x is a food, implies that it likes by John. Okay, so it will be written as a not for all x, not if x is not a food, or x is liked by John. Okay, so it in the first step of conversion of first order logic into CNF, firstly we eliminate all the implication. So same like that, in the third statement or in the fifth statement, sixth statement or seventh statement, all we actually remove all type of implications. So after that. Move negation inwards and rewrite. Okay, so once we move negation inwards and rewrite, then see we can write this statement like this, as you can see here. Okay, after that rename variable or standardize variable. Okay, rename variable or standardized variable. So all the variables are renamed, and or you can say that we standardize the variable. After that, eliminate existential or instantial qualifier by elimination. Okay, so in this step we will actually eliminate existential qualifier, that is the as you know that just opposite of E is written as a existential quantifier. So we just eliminate that, and in this process is known as schemization. Okay, schemization. So but this is in this example problem, since there is a no existential qualifier, so all the statement will be remain same. Okay, so next after that, drop universal quantifier. So in this step we will drop all universal quantifiers, since all the statement are not implicitly quantified, so we don't need it. Okay, so see guys, in the next step what we did, we drop all the universal quantifier also. So we just drop all the universal quantifier. After that, we just distribute conjunction over disjunction not. Okay, so this step will not make any change in this problem, so let it be. Okay, after that negate the statement to be proven. So in this statement we will apply negation to the conclusion statement, which will be written as a not like negation of likes John and peanuts. So just after that, in the fourth step what we do, just draw the resolution graph. Okay, just draw the resolution graph. So now in this step we will solve the problem. Okay, we will solve the problem by resolution tree using substitution. So for the above problem, we will given as a follows. So as you can see here that we just draw a resolution graph. Okay, resolution graph tree. Okay, so it was hence proved. It is the hence proved and hence the negation of conclusion has been proved as a complete construction with the given set of statement. So explanation of the resolution graph is this. In the first step of resolution graph, that is not like John, comma peanuts and like John, comma X get resolved, that is cancelled by substitution of peanut slash X. Okay, means X is substituted by peanuts, and we are left with a not food peanuts. So in the second step of resolution graph, not food peanut and food Z get resolved, cancelled by substituting of peanut slash Z. Means Z will be substituted from the peanut. So we will are left with a not eats Y, comma peanuts or killed Y. So in this third step of the resolution graph, not eat Y peanuts and eat Anil, comma peanuts get resolved by substitution of Anil, comma Y. Okay, and we are left with the killed, comma Anil. So in this fourth step of the resolution graph, killed Anil and not killed K get resolved by substitution Anil slash K, means K is substituted by Anil, and we are left with not alive Anil. So in the last step of the resolution graph, not alive Anil and alive Anil get resolved. Okay guys, so this is how resolution rule is applied on any statement. Okay, so just took any another example and just apply these steps to understand the resolution rule. Okay, and after that you will understand how these rules are actually work. Is termed as an inference. So what is inference rule? So inference rules are the template for generating valid arguments. Okay, you can say inference rule are applied to derive proofs in artificial intelligence, and the proofs is a sequence of conclusion that lead to the desired goal. So in our inference rule, the implication among all the connectives play an important role. So following are some terminology related to inference rule. First terminology is a implication, second is a converse, and third is a contrapositive, and then inverse. So these are some terminology which are actually used. Okay. So first understand what is implications. Okay. So implication is one of the logical connectives which can be represented as a P implies Q. So it is a Boolean expression. Okay, it is a Boolean expression, and it converses, which means that right hand side proposition goes to left hand side and vice versa. So it can be written as a Q implies B. Okay. Next one is a contrapositive. The negation of converse is termed as a contrapositive, and it can be represented as not Q implies not P. Okay, not Q implies not P, and next one is inverse. So negation of implication is called inverse in the and it is represented as negation of P implies negation of Q. So for this all four terminology, I am showing here the truth table for that. Okay, so here I am taking two proposition, that is P and Q, and see for the third column I am showing an implication. In the fourth column I am showing a converse, and the third column fifth column contrapositive, and sixth column is a inverse. So first what is implication? Okay, so it show that P implies Q. So for that, in the third column we actually apply the implication rule, that is if and then rule. So same for that, we already understand the implication rule means it give the result false only if condition is true and then condition is false. So only in the second row it give a value false, because the value of P is true but Q value is false. So in that case it give a only false value, and other than that it will be true. Okay, next one is a converse. Okay, so in converse again took a value of Q first and then a value of P then after that value of P. So in the first case both value are true, so obviously true, result value is true. In the second case the value of Q is false and value of P is true. So if value of Q is true means first if condition is false, then we didn't check the value of then condition. Okay, whatever the then condition, in that case the result will be true. So if condition is false, then obviously it will give a true value. So second row give a true value. Now again the third row Q value is true but P value is false. So if condition is true but then condition is false, so only in that condition it return the value false. So in a third row I am writing a false value, and again both are false, then in that case obviously true value are resulted. So do you understand the converse? Okay, now next is contrapositive, right? Contrapositive means contrapositive is negation of converse. So negation of converse in term as a is term as a contrapositive. So means negation of Q implies negation of P. So first we actually negate the value of Q. So in a first case value of Q is true, so for this condition we took false, right? So obviously first condition is false, so the second condition we are not checking, means then condition we are not checking. So obviously here I'm writing a true. Okay, now again second condition, firstly in the second column you know that the second row and the value of Q is written as a F. If we apply a negation operation, then definitely value become a true. So first if condition is true, now we have to check about the P, as P value is written as a true, so not P, negation of P is false. So in that case first premises mean if condition is true but then condition is false, so in that case obviously it give a false value. So that's why in the second column of contrapositive it is written as a false. Now again for the third case Q is false, Q is true, so definitely not Q, negation of Q is a false. So if condition is false, we are not checking the second condition. So same like that we put here as a true. Now in the fourth column, now in the fourth row Q value is false and P value is also false. So negation of Q is also true, negation of P is also true. If both are true, then obviously it result the value true. Okay. Now, for the inverse, what happened if negation of implication is called inverse? Means not P implies not Q is called inverse. Okay, excuse me. Okay, here I am taking a value of P and Q first. So P value is true and Q value is true. So if we negate both of them, then obviously first value for P value is false and Q value is also false. So if condition is false, we don't need to check about the then condition. We directly put write the result true. Okay. Now again second condition, okay, the value of P is again false because the value of negation P is false because value of P is true, right? So again if condition is false, then we need not to check about the then condition. So I'm writing a true. Okay, directly I'm writing a true. Now in this third case, negation of P is true and negation of Q is false. Okay, negation of Q is false. Okay, remember that I'm talking about the negation of P and negation Q in the third row. Okay, so the value of P is false and value of Q is true. So obviously negation of P is true and negation of Q is false. So false, a first value is true, but second means if condition is true, but then condition is false. So in that case, obviously it result the false. Now in the again next condition, if we apply negation on P and negation on Q, so we will get a result true for the fourth condition. So if both are true, obviously result will be true. So guys, if you check that the inverse and converse both are equivalent to each other, and implication and contrapositive, implication and contrapositive, these both are equivalent to each other, right? These both are equivalent to each other. So guys, a rule of inference, or you can say that inference rule or transformation rule, okay, in a logical forms, it actually consisting of function which takes premises and analyze their syntax and return the conclusion. So for example, a rule of inference calls rule of inference there are so many rule of inference. So let's understand how many types of rule of inference are present. Okay, so These are the types of rule of inference. First type is modus ponens. Second type is modus tollens. Third is hypothetical syllogism, and the fourth is disjunctive syllogism, and fifth is addition, sixth is simplification, and seventh is resolution. Okay, so first understand what is modus ponens. Okay, so guys, the modus ponens rule is one of the most important rule in inference. Okay, in our inference, and it state that if P and P implies Q is true, then we can infer that Q will be true. Means if P is true, okay, the value of P is true, and P implies Q is true, then we can say that Q will be also true. Okay, so it can be represented as the notation. You can see here. The notation of modus ponens is written like that. P implies Q, and also P. Then in that case, Q will be true. Okay. For example, if I am sleepy, okay, if I am sleepy, then I go to bed. So for that, I am writing an implication rule that P implies Q. Means for P, I am writing I am sleepy. For Q, one statement is if I am sleepy, then I go to bed. Okay, and in which Q statement two that I am sleepy. Okay. So what conclusion will be found? Then means I go to bed. Means a one statement is given that if I am sleepy, then I will go to bed. And second statement say that I am sleepy, then obviously you will go to the bed. Okay, so hence we can say that if P implies true and Q is true, then in that case Q will be true. So so guys, it can be proved by the creating a truth table. So guys, see, in a truth table I'm taking a two value of two proposition, that is P and Q, and so for that we apply the proposition rule, right? Implication rule. So in the first condition both are false, then what the happened? P implies Q. In the first condition, sorry guys, in the first condition there is a one mistake in this. For the implication rule, in the first column it should be a value 1 in the first column. It should be a value 1. But guys, for the modus ponens, it give the result false, because in which P is not true, right? P is not true. So for the result of modus ponens, it is written here, zero. Okay, so here you cannot write P implies Q. Here you have to write P implies Q and P. Okay. Only in that case you will have a value zero. Okay, again for the same, P implies Q will give P implies Q give a one value result one, and the value of P is zero, so obviously it will be zero. So let it be. Now in the second case, P is true and Q is zero, false, right? So if we are talking about the implication rule, definitely it will give a value. If it will give a value, false, right? And the value of P is true. So true and false, obviously it will give a value false. So let it be. So guys, both are true, right? If both are true, then implication after implication apply, then obviously result will be true. And also see, the value of P is also true. Then you check that the conclusion, that is Q, is also true, right? Means the value of P implies Q, and here I am taking and as a conjunction, okay? Conjunction with P, okay? The result of P implication Q conjunct with the P, okay? So if they give a value true, so definitely the conclusion means, conclusion what given, that then in that case Q will be also true. So see guys, in the truth table it shows that P implication Q is obviously true, because both value are true, and the value of P is also true. If we if we conjunct the true and true, then definitely result will be true. So in that case we see that the value of Q is also true. Okay, next is modus tollens. Okay, the modus tollens rule state that if P implies Q is true and not Q is true, then not P also true. Okay, so modus tollens show that So modus tenens, state that if P implies Q is true and not Q is true, then not P is also true. So it can be written as a P implies Q and not Q. Okay, and not Q. Okay. So the conclusion will be definitely a not P. So I am taking an example. Statement 1 say that if I am sleepy, then I go to bed. Okay, this so that P implies Q. Now statement 2 that say that I am not go to bed. Then obviously what conclusion will be infer that? It infer that I am not sleepy. Because we in a first statement we say I am sleepy, then I go to bed. Okay. Then in second statement, I am not go to bed. Obviously, then it means it's infer that I am not sleepy. Okay. So just take a, I'm proofing with that by using a truth table. So guys, firstly, I have to prepare the truth table for P implies Q. So guys, P implies Q. Obviously, both are zero. Then in that case, result will be one. First condition P is false and second condition Q is a true, then obviously true, but P is true and Q is false. So in that case, P implies Q is zero, and again for true, it's true. So guys, see, now I am actually ending with not Q. Okay, not Q. And if the result will be true, so in that case, not P is also true. Okay, so guys, in the column number 4 and column number 5, I am ending. Okay, means I am applying a conjunction rule. So first, in the first case, both are true, right? So obviously result will be true. So see guys, result will be true, and in that case we see that the not P value is also true. Not P value is also true. Now again for the second case, not Q is false and P implies Q is 1. So obviously after applying the conjunction rule, it give a result 0, a result false, right? So we need not to check about the not P, what is not P and all that. Because statement is only says that if P implies Q and means conjunction not Q, well, result the true, then in that case not P is not P is true. So guys, let it be. Now in the third case, P implies Q is value 0 and not Q is 1, so obviously result will be 0. So let it be. Again for P implies Q is 1 and not Q is 0, so let it be, because result is 0. So guys, it proved that by using a modus tenens that if P implies Q is true and not Q is true, then in that case, it infer that not P is also true. Okay. Next one is hypothetical syllogism. So the hypothetical syllogism rule state that if P implies R is a true, R is true whenever P implies Q is true, and Q implies R is true, then it can be represented as the following notation. Okay, following notation. So following notation. So for example, if you have my home key, for example, if you have my home key, okay. Then you can unlock my home. Means it shows that P implies Q. Statement Q say that if you cannot unlock my home, then you cannot take my money. Okay. The statement shows that Q implies R. Okay. Statement two shows that Q implies R. So if we reach to the conclusion that if you have my home key, then you can take my money. Okay. Only in that if you don't have my key, then you cannot take my money, right? So by using a truth table, I am proving this. So guys, I am taking here three proposition P, Q, and R. Okay. So first of all, we firstly make a truth value for P implies Q, and then Q implies R, and then check that if both value only if these both value are true, then only in that case P implies R true. So guys, see in the value of fourth and fifth column, the first row, both value are true, and also the result are true, right? So second value, both in the second row, both value are true, so result will be true, right? In the third, both value are not true, so let it be. In the fourth row, both value are true, so result are also true. Again, for fifth row, both are not true. Sixth row, both are not true. Seventh row, both are not true. Again, in eighth row, both value are true, so result will be also true. Means by using a truth table, we show that if P implies Q is true and Q implies R are true, then in that case, P implies R are also true. Okay. Next one is disjunction. Disjunction syllogism. So in this rule state that if P or Q is true and not P is true, then Q will be true. So it will be represented as P or Q and not P. Okay. So I'm taking an example. Today is Sunday or Monday. So it can be written as a P or Q. Okay. Today is Sunday or Monday. And statement two, that today is not Sunday, means it is not P. So what conclusion we reach? That today is Monday. Okay. So by using a truth table, we show that the firstly we calculate that the P or Q. So in that case, we apply a conjunction rule on not P and the result of P or Q. So guys, in the first case, obviously result will be zero. So let it be. In the second case, result will be zero. Result will be true, and we see that the value of Q is also true, right? Again, for the third row, result will be zero. So let it be. And in the fourth case, result will be zero. So let it be, right? Next one is addition. Okay. So in addition rule, the addition rule is one of the common inference rule, and it states that if P is true, then P, P or Q will be true. Okay, if P is true, then P or Q will be true. So we are taking an example. If I have a vanilla ice cream, that is P. Okay, and statement two say that I have a chocolate ice cream. Okay, so conclusion is I have vanilla or chocolate ice cream. So by using a truth table, it shows that firstly it calculates the P or Q value, right? P or Q value. So only in two condition it shows the result true. That if P is true, see guys, if P is true, then P or Q is also true. And also see that if P is true, then the value of P or Q is also true. Next one is simplification. Okay, so simplification rule state that if P and Q is true, then Q or P will also be true. It can be represented as in the notion of simplification rule is written like that. So for that, P and Q we firstly calculate through the P and Q proposition. So only one case, it shows that the result, see that if both value P and if P and Q are only true, if P or Q are true. Okay. Next one is resolution. Okay. So the resolution state that if P or Q and not P and not P and R are true, then Q or R will also be true. So it can be represented as. So guys, firstly you need to make a truth table for that, and only in third three case it give a result to you, right? So guys, so in the today's lecture, we will learn about this. Okay, we will learn about the all the inference rule and all the things. Okay, so here is your homework, which you have to done after learning this lesson. Okay. So guys, go through this book, Artificial Intelligence, which is written by Richard Knight, in which there are so many more examples are given. You can just prove them through the by using the truth table, or there are so many sentences are written there. So just go and learn from this book. Okay.